Okay, so how is everyone today? Good? So, the projector's not working today, so we'll put it on the whiteboard. Last time we were talking about polynomials. We're still talking about polynomials. So we're in section 1.5, which is called something like factoring. So specifically, when you do this, A multiplied by B plus C. A multiplied by B plus C, what is the name for how product and sum interact with each other?
Distribution.
Distribution. So this is AC, I'm sorry, AB plus AC. So this is what we've been doing essentially all the time. Going this direction, this is distribution. What we're doing today is we're going in the other direction. This other direction is called factoring. Okay. So now, example. What if I was to give you x cubed y squared plus 12, no, not 12, about 15 x squared y to 5, and then minus 20 x to 5. So there's three terms altogether. And among the terms, I'd like for you to observe that there's three different varieties of symbol. There's the coefficients, that is to say the numbers. There's the x things, and then there's the y things. Okay. Now, among the coefficients, let's ignore the x's and the y's momentarily, and just look at the coefficients, 60, 15, and negative 20. Is there anything that's common among them? Five, right? All of them have a factor of 5 in them, which is to say that we should be able to write that this is 5 multiplied by something. 5 comes out of all of those. So now my question to you is what goes in there? 5 multiplied by what? So for the first term, if we took 5 out, what would remain?
12.
And then the x's and the y's are unaffected. So 12x cubed y squared. And then the second term? 3x squared y to 5. And the last term? Any question about doing that? Notably, observe the coefficients that remain inside of the parentheses. Is there anything that's common to all of them? Is there anything that's common to all of them that's not one? Any integers? Is 3 common to all of them? 3 is a factor of 12. 3 is a factor of 3, but what? But it's not a factor of 4. Or, alternatively, 4 is a factor of 12, and 4 is a factor of this one, so why can't we take a 4 out? It's not a factor of all of them. Not a factor of all of the coefficients. Okay, so There's no more common factors among the coefficients. So now I'm going to do something that you may protest to a little bit, but I'm going to do it anyway. And I want you to tell me what your protestation is. So then observe now that there's x's. So I see, all of them have an x. I'm going to take out an x. Just one x. So if I take out just one x, then please list off for me the other terms. So what about the first one?
12x squared y squared.
Plus, what's the next one?
3xy
to 5. The next term?
4x to 4.
4x to 4, y to 3. Okay, so I did it. Now what's your protest against me doing this?
You should have taken out two x's.
Right. Observe the terms that are in here. Do they all still have some x's? Yeah, they all still have x's. So now I'm going to take out more x. How much more x can I take out?
One
more, right? So now I'm going to do that. Okay. 5xx. And then what remains if I do that is 12xy squared plus 3y to 5 minus 4x3y to 3. And of course, we have a shorter way to write xx. What's that?
Square x squared.
Okay, so x squared can come out because among the powers of x, right, this x cubed means x, x, x. There's a factor of x, another one, and another one. Here this means x, x. There's an x, and there's another. Here this means x, 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 x. There's five of them. So that means that all of them have two x's to give. And the way you can see this numerically is consider, what are the exponents for x here? What's the exponent? 3, this one, this one. Among those numbers we just said, which is smallest? 2. That means that x squared is what can come out. So, your protestation is that this was inefficient, I think. Okay, so now let's be efficient. Let's take out the maximum number of y's. What can come out?
Y squared.
Y squared can come out. Because among the y's, here we have y squared, y to fifth, and y to 3. 2, 5, and 3. Among those, which is smallest?
2.
So that means that we can write 5x squared y squared. And then if we do that, 12x plus 3y cubed minus 4x cubed. Any question about this? Okay. So this thing right here is called the greatest common factor. And it's typically initialized to GCF. Initialized to GCF. Okay, so any question about this? So if I was to give you a crazy looking thing and said, factor out the GCF, this is what I want you to do. Okay. Now, first remark is that given a polynomial with integer coefficients, and the leading coefficient 1. So a polynomial that has integer coefficients and its leading coefficient is 1. All mathematicians have a special place in their hearts for such polynomials. These are called monic. So an example would be something like x squared plus 6x plus 17, or 7, since I wrote 7. This is an example of a monic polynomial. Okay. What is the degree of this polynomial?
2.
Yeah. Degree 2. Because the term of highest degree is this one. What is the coefficient of this term?
1.
It's 1. Because it's not written, it's implied. One. So this one, this polynomial is monic. How about this one? Is this monic?
No.
Not monic. Not according to this definition of monic. Why not?
Sorry, coefficients are integers.
Right. This is not an integer. Yes, I agree that this is 1. I do agree. But all the coefficients are not integers, so it's not monic. Yes, no, and then about 8x squared plus 7x minus 10. Is this monic?
No.
Not monic. All the coefficients are integers. But the leading coefficient is not 1. Okay, so first part of the remark. Any question about the word monic? So basically, to foreshadow what's going to happen throughout the semester is that, like I said, mathematicians have a special place in their heart for monic polynomials. And when you're doing an exercise and it deals with a polynomial and it happens to be monic, that's a situation, that's a cause for celebration. Yeah. Oh, yay! Because that means that everything works a little better when you have a monic polynomial. Everything's a little more complicated when it isn't. Okay. So second part of that remark. Is let's consider the following. X plus A multiplied by X plus B. Well, we could do this. We did this last time. The FOIL. I just multiply and collect. So what would be the F term?
X squared.
X squared. What would be the O term?
XB.
Okay, and I'll write BX. And the I term? AX. And then the L term?
AB.
AB. So now, four terms, FOIL. The terms in the middle, the O and the I. So ignore the F and the L for a moment. The O and the I, do they have a common factor? Yes, of X. So you could write this as X squared plus A plus B X plus AB. So you could write it in this way. Notably, what I want you to observe is that this coefficient is a sum, and this coefficient is a product of the same number. So now, what we're going to do is we're going to, and one other thing I want to you to observe is that how about this polynomial that I have written? Is it monic?
I mean,
maybe
I don't know if they're
integers. Ah, very good. I like that. So, assuming that A and B themselves are integers, will this be monic? So, let's have an example of doing this. So what we want to do is we want to take expressions that look like this, that look like this one right here, and we want to turn them into expressions that look like that. This is an example of factoring. This is undoing distribution. Because remember, after all, that FOIL is just a shortcut that does 1, 2, 3 distributions in a commutation. So now we want to undo that commutation and those three distributions. So, for example, so would someone please give me 2 positive integers? Maybe 1 and another one.
3 and 4.
3 and 4. So I want you to factor x squared plus 7x plus 12. And I hope you might object just slightly and say, you asked her for integers, she gave you 3 and 4, you just ignore her? Is that how you're going to do that? No, right? So somehow I did ignore her. Okay. So what we want to do is we want to find 2 integers, generally speaking, we want to find 2 numbers whose product is 12. Whose product is 12, and whose sum is what? Notably, I'd like for you to observe that the polynomial I gave you has leading coefficient 1. Okay, so we're going to mount a search. So here's the factors. And here's the sum. So what we want to do is we want to factor 12. Okay, how about 1 and 12? Well, what's the sum of 1 and 12? 13. Is that what we were looking for? No, it's not what we're looking for. What are we looking for, by the way? 7. Okay. How about 2 and 6? What's the sum of 2 and 6? 8. Is that what we were looking for? No. I guess we're all out of options. Yeah, that's it. There's no more. No, all right, there's one more. So what is it?
3 and 4.
What's the sum of 3 and 4?
7.
So you observe, that's what we were looking for. So that tells us, then, what the factorization of that polynomial is. What's its factorization? So x squared 7x plus 12 factors as what?
x plus 3 multiplied by x plus 4.
Now you might look at this and say, sounds a little bit magic to me. How could you verify that this is in fact correct?
Plug in a number. Distribute.
Yeah, you could do FOIL on the right hand side. If you were to do FOIL on the right-hand side, what would be the F term?
X squared.
1x squared. That's good. What would be the L term?
12.
12. Is that good?
Yes.
That's good. What would be the O and the I term?
7x.
4x and 3x, whose sum is 7x. Is that good? That's good. Okay, so any question about this one? So now that you see the way this works, let's do one more. How about w squared plus 17w minus 60? I messed it up by putting negatives in there. So, we're looking for numbers whose product is what? Negative 60. Whose sum is what? Is 17. Okay. So, I'm fully aware that you probably more or less understand this now, and you could just in your head figure out numbers to do this, but I'm going to do it one more time. So, factors. So what's the sum? Negative 59. So here's an example that a human wouldn't even really consider. Humans just don't even do this one usually. So, however, notably, I'd like for you to observe that one of the factors needs to be positive and the other negative. So there's that. Another matter is that notice that I chose the in magnitude. The small one to be positive and the big one to be negative. But that's not what we want. Why do we not want that? Because 17 is positive. So we need the bigger one. We need the bigger one to be the positive one so that the resulting sum will be positive. Okay. How about one way to factor 60 is 5 and 12. And what's the sum of 5 and 12?
17.
Is that the answer? Well, I got a 17. What's the product of 5 and 12?
60.
Positive 60. Are we looking for positive 60? We're looking for negative 60. An error such as this is a very common kind of error that students make on this exercise. So we need negatives. Okay. So let's skip to the end. So what are the factors that do it for us?
20 and negative 3.
Okay. So then the sum of negative 3 and 20 is 17. Okay, so what does that tell us about the factorization?
Becomes W minus 3 multiplied by W plus 20.
Very good. W minus 3 multiplied by W plus 20. Okay. And you can verify this with FOIL. Any question about this one? Okay. Last one in this sequence. How about z squared plus 5z minus 13? So, notably, you're looking for two numbers whose product is negative 13 and whose sum is 5. Now, until now, when we've been saying that, I made it to where there would be an answer that always was among the integers. Now, the complication here is that 13 is prime. What does that mean?
It's only factors 2, 13, 1.
Right. Among the integers, its only factors are 1 and 13. So you can't make it go through with integers. Does that mean that this just doesn't factor? But it does mean it does not factor among the integers. But it still factors. So what I want you to observe is that here's an example that this method does not work on. Doesn't work. So we won't be able to do this, but not today. By the time we do this, the answer will be something like, one of the factors is z minus negative 5 minus the square root of 200 and something, all that divided by 2. And then the other factor is z minus negative 5 plus the square root of that same 200 something, all divided by 2. Okay, but today, we have nothing else to say except what to do. Okay, so what if, now, instead of giving you a monic polynomial to factor, I give you one that's not monic, then what? So, suppose I want you to factor polynomial that looks like this, ax squared plus bx plus c, where a is not 0, a is not 0, and b is not, and a is not 1. So that is to say, I want to give you a degree 2 polynomial, and I have to say a is not 0 because If it were zero, then it wouldn't be a degree 2 polynomial. And I have to say not 1, because otherwise it'd be monic. So how do you deal with this? It's the exact same strategy. Almost. Except you want to find two numbers whose product is AC and whose sum is B. So what's happened is that now the leading coefficient is in play. Now the leading coefficient is in play too. And this is a contrast to what if I gave you this polynomial, x squared plus bx plus c. So how about that one? What's its leading coefficient? 1. And so we would want to find two things whose product is
c.
1 times c and whose sum is b. So notice that here's a 1. So really the method that we were just doing is a special case of this one. Special case of this one when the leading coefficient A is 1. Okay. Except on this kind where the leading coefficient really isn't 1, there's a lot more work to do. So let's do it. Factor 5x squared plus 7x minus 6. Notably, not monic. Okay. Now the strategy is we want to find two numbers whose product is what?
Negative 6,
which is, I agree, negative 30. And whose sum is what?
7.
Okay, so before we do anything, is there any question about why this is the task at hand? Two numbers whose product is negative 30 and whose sum is positive 7. Okay? out. Negative 1 and 30. Does that work? No. Okay. So now, probably, I think in your head, you can kind of quickly go down the list. Can you think of any two numbers whose product is negative 30 and whose sum is positive 7?
Negative 3 and 10.
Okay. Negative 3 and positive 10. So is there any question about getting to this position? Now the question is what do we do with this information? What do we do with this information? Okay. So what this 7 tells us, what this negative 3 and 10 tells us, it tells us how we're going to split this 7x. We're going to split the 7x and say that, well, first we're going to get negative 3x's. Then we're going to get 10x's. So, we're going to take this and say, 5x squared plus 7x minus 6, this is equal to 5x squared minus 3x plus 10x minus 6. So the first and the last term are the same as before. But for reasons that are not entirely clear yet, we're saying, well, 7x, that's fine, but I like thinking of it as negative 3x plus 10x. Okay. So, any question about getting here? So now, instead of having three terms, which we have on the left-hand side, now we have four terms. And what we're going to do is we're going to split group in the following way. We're going to say that this is 5x squared minus 3x and then plus 10x minus 6. So because we have four terms now, that means we can make two groups of two. So within the first group now, there's the greatest common factor. What is the greatest common factor in the first group? X is the greatest common factor in the first group. So X multiplied by something plus, what's the greatest common factor in the second group? 2. Which is to say that we should be able to write in those parentheses what is left over after taking out the greatest common factor. So if we do this, what goes in the first set of parentheses?
5x minus 3.
5x minus 3. And what goes in the second set of parentheses?
5x minus 3.
5x minus 3. Do you observe that we got the same thing twice? That is a signal that we have done this correctly. If those weren't the same, that would be a signal that you have made an error. So now, what I want you to observe is that this 5x minus 3 is now common to this and that. It occurs in both of them. It occurs in this one, it's a factor here, with the other factor being x, and it's a factor here with the other factor being 2. So that means that this red thing is common. So we could factor out red thing. So I'll do it. Which is to say that we ought to be able to write something times red thing. Something times red thing. So So my question and the answer to the exercise is, well, what goes in there? What goes in there?
X plus 2.
X plus 2, right? So this x is the other factor with 5x plus 3. So this goes here, x, and then plus, and then 2. How could you verify that this is correct?
FOIL.
Multiply it back out. So if we were to FOIL, what would be the leading term? 5x squared. Is that correct? What would be the trailing, the constant term? Negative 6. Is that good? Good. What about the O term? Negative 3x's. And the I term? Positive 10x's. Positive 10x's minus 3x's is? 7x's. Question about this? Okay. So the exact same thing was actually occurring with that other method, except that because the coefficient is 1, because the polynomial is monic, almost all of these steps just collapse down into a single step and it becomes far easier. So this is what I meant in comparison to the previous exercise compared to this one. Having a monic polynomial is a cause for celebration. Let's do another one. Because of course, that's what we're talking about. Okay, so now it's illustrative for me to explain how does an instructor do this. So literally, I'm going to go back to my office and do something more or less like this. I say, okay, 4x minus 3 multiplied by 2x. I'm going to FOIL this out real quick. So that would be 8x squared, and then plus 20 minus 6, so that would be plus 14, and then minus 15. Okay, so then this I'm going to say that this is hidden. So we're going to go with the fiction that that's invisible.
It's invisible.
And now I'll say, okay, I want you to factor 8x squared plus 14x minus 15. Of course, the answer is that right there. That's the answer. But it's invisible. Okay, so what I want you to do is I want you to carry out this procedure, showing all steps. Now, to sort of head something off, pass, you might say something like, well, I know a shorter way to do this. Okay, terrific. You won't receive credit for it. Okay. I'll tell you the shortest way is just go to Wolfram Alpha and just type it in there. That's as short as can be. Don't care. And I want to see your work. Okay. So, we want to find two numbers. And what has to be true about these numbers? We want their product to be what? Right. So we want their product to be 8 times negative 15, which is negative 120. Wolfram Alpha is a website, by the way. It can do a lot of algebra problems. But this is the method that's required to get credit. And then what's the sum that we want? So we want two numbers whose product is negative 120, whose sum is positive 14. So here's the search. So now let's start being more realistic and say, okay, a human being would not start with 1. Okay, not going to happen. So let's start in a more reasonable place. How about 10 and 20? and I need one, or sorry, 10 and 12, and I need one of them to be negative. So how about negative 10 and positive 12? What's the sum? 2. Is that what we were looking for? It's not it. So that means that I need the disparity between the numbers to get bigger, because I need this 2 to be 14, so I need it to be bigger. So I need to make these numbers get further apart, in a sense. So how about negative 8 and positive 15? What's the sum? Sum is 7. Is that what we were looking for? No, but we're going in the correct direction. So how about negative 6 and 20? Will that do it? This doesn't. This doesn't. So that's 14. So does everybody observe? We found what we were looking for. So what does that 14 tell us? What does this row in the table tell us? It tells us our next action. What is our next action? Is that we're given this trinomial. And what we want to do is we want to turn it into a quadrinomial. 4 terms. And the way we're going to turn it, we're going to turn it from 3 terms to 4 terms is we're going to split the middle term. How are we going to split it? Negative 6x's and positive 20x's. That's how we're going to split it, turning it into a quadrinomial. So then, continuing up here, it would be 8x squared minus 6x's plus 20x's, and then minus 15. So we turned it into a quadrinomial. The purpose, thinking from the end and working backwards, the purpose of turning this into a quadrinomial is that we wanted to make 2 groups of 2. And you can't make 2 groups of 2 until you have 4 terms. Okay, in each one, now let's factor out the greatest common factor. In the first group, the greatest common factor is what?
2x.
2x. In the second group?
5.
This should say 20. And I agree, 5. So, now, if I factor 2x out of here, then I get 4x minus 3. And if I factor 5 out of here, then I get 4x minus 9. So, when you make an error on the paper, it's hard to tell that you actually made an error in many circumstances. But I claim that right here in this exact position, actually, it's fairly easy to tell that you've made an error. What is our signal that what I have presently written is not correct? Yeah, they don't match. The red things should match at this point. So, they don't match. Oh, I must have made an error. Oh, that 9 should be a 3. Does everyone see that? Okay. So then, do you observe that red thing is a factor of the first and the last? So it can be factored out. Which is to say, we can write 4x minus 3 here, and then if we do that, what goes in the first?
2x plus 5.
2x plus 5. Is that what we started with? Yes. Yes?
So when, instead of writing 8x squared minus 6x, can you do 8x squared plus 20x minus
5? I like it. So I think you're saying that, well, we split it into a quadrinomial like this. What if you put this one first and that one next? Would it still work? I think is your question.
Yeah.
It must. Okay. So do it in your own time and check. But it doesn't matter. Typically, I do the negative 1 first. because the arithmetic and the algebra is just slightly easier. So which is to say, I put the negative one here and the positive one here. But you could do it either way. How much time is it? 2 minutes, good. So. Than the previous one. Notably, it's monic. So here's one way to solve this exercise. You can say, well, this is x squared plus how many x's? Zero of them. And then minus 64. So now you want two numbers whose product is negative 64 and whose sum is zero. When you think of two numbers whose sum is negative, whose product is negative 64 and whose sum is zero. Okay. Alternatively, you could say, well, this is x squared minus 8 squared, which is the difference of squares. The difference of squares. Don't we have a phrase that contains different the subphrase difference of squares in it? It is the difference of squares is the something that starts with P.
Product of conjugates.
Product of conjugates. Observe. X plus 8 and X minus 8 are conjugate binomials. So it factors into X plus 8 times X minus 8. Okay. That being the case now, I think I can give you this one. You should be able to respond immediately. How about, please factor w squared minus 9. How does this factor? Good. And just one of my quirks. Any question that has w's in it, I'm going to put 3's in it. Because I think W's and 3's look funny in the same exercise. So last thing. What if we do this? How about P squared minus 5? And I want you to factor this. Factors. And you know how to do it. So there's an intermediate step that occurred on this one, and you just did it immediately. You did it in your head, and you did it so quick, it's hidden even from you. What you did here intermediately is you said, well, this is w squared minus 3 squared. So you made an intermediate representation of that as the difference of two squares. 9 can be written as 3 squared. How do you express 5 as a square?
Square root of 5.
Square root of 5. Squared. Okay. So then this is p squared minus square root of 5 squared. Now it's the difference of squares. So the answer is p plus square root of 5 by p minus square root of 5. Of course, this could also be written as w plus the square root of 9 multiplied by w minus the square root of 9. The only distinction is that you know that 9 has an integer square root. And you don't ever write square root 9, you always write 3. And the hesitation that you had when you looked at this exercise was exactly and only because 5 doesn't have an integer square root. And you have just a slight bit of hesitation and maybe even revulsion about it. But there's nothing in principle wrong with it. Good. Have a nice Wednesday.